stand up for a moment and can we just pray? We're going to just worship a couple songs and then we'll got a Mother's Day presentation, some announcements. I'm going to preach on spiritual warfare again this morning, but short, get you out of here. And we want to hopefully at the end of the service today, we will have sensed that we've been with the Lord and that our mothers have been honored in every way possible. Father, I just draw near to you. Your word says and promises, Lord, that if we draw near to you, you will draw near to us. You have declared that we are your children. You've declared that we are your heirs.
Yes.
We cry out, Abba, Father, Abba, Daddy, Papa. We come with an intimacy before your presence this morning. We thank you, Lord, that you draw us in. And Father, that you hunger and thirst for our attention. That you desire our attention as we hunger and thirst for your presence, God. Lord, as we worship you, we want to just, Lord, forgive us for spectating. Forgive us for the times that we've sat back and just said, Lord, we'll let somebody else praise your name. We'll let somebody else prophesy your goodness and favor. Help us to step into that prophecy this morning, into that proclamation of your goodness, your mightiness, your awesomeness, your wonderfulness. Lord, I know we've got plans today. Some are here, maybe even deal with lack of plans, but Lord, help us not be distracted in these next few moments. Help us to enter into the very depth of your presence, that your presence would manifest in this place. Lord, we know you're here because your word promises that you are in the midst of the praises of your people. And so as we praise you and as we rejoice, as we lift you up, we thank you, God, that you've already redeemed us. You've already healed us. You've already delivered us. You've already set us free. You've already broken the chains of bondage, broken the chains of addiction, broken the chains of lust and sin. You have set us free in you. And Jesus, we come before you this morning, simply laid out, transparent and vulnerable. Say, Lord, fill us. Encompass us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's worship the Lord together.
Jesus conquered the grave. Savior,
Mother's Day. How many moms out there in the place? We're gonna take a break here, but we're gonna do something a little different this morning. This happens not only to be Mother's Day, but it also happens to be BGMC Sunday. So here's the deal: second Sunday of the month, we're trying to figure out how we're gonna make this work. So here's what we're gonna do. While we're in the midst of our break, we've got a couple kids. Is that right? We've got a couple kids. Are they here? Right, come on up here, boys and girls. Who are the two kids? So we got this set up. So they're gonna come around and get your change. Okay. Now, just want to let you know, if you give them your offering, it's gonna make the offering at the end of the service really light. So we might be careful on that. But they're looking for change for boys and girls for their missionary offerings. We've been kind of tying those in this last couple months. And so that's going to go. But let's stand, and let's take a minute. Let's get around and connect with one another. And we will just have a wonderful morning, and we'll come back in just a few minutes.
Hi, happy Mother's Day, love. Good to see you. I didn't know you were going to be here. You're amazing.
Just down to visit, huh?
Okay, we'll do that. You fell on your wrist? Yeah. You want me to pray for it right now or after service?
Right now, because I'm in the mail.
Lord Jesus, we just thank you so much for a wonderful sister Karen. We love her so much, Lord. I just pray that you would just fill her up with your Holy Spirit and fire right now, Father God. Just fill her up right now with your Holy Spirit. I command all pain and all injury in this hand to go right now in the name of Jesus. All inflammation.
Mother's Day. We'll focus on that in a second. Meanwhile,
back at the OK Corral.
Meanwhile, there is a bulletin that if you haven't got it, there's a card in there. We'd love to have everybody fill this out. Our consultant was here last week and he says, you know what? One suggestion I have is make sure that everybody, even those who are here, even if you just put your first name on it, everybody fills this out. If you're visiting with us, we'd love to at least know that you were here. And we sell this information for lots of money, and you'll know. We protect that information. But it does help us to know that you're here this morning, and there's a lot of ways to be involved with us. If you have an email, you can definitely get a newsletter that gets sent out, which has all the announcements that I'm not going to say. As well as, if you have a smartphone or a tablet, you can download our app on there, Discovery Fellowship, and all the notes from the messages, the newsletter, everything, down to even giving is on there. I would say about a third of our giving is now online of our people, and that's pretty healthy. And I'll tell you why, because when people don't come to church, they don't give. But now if they're giving online, guess what? They give either way. So it's like the faithfulness is there. It's awesome. It's going to grow. And it helps us to budget to know as we move things helpful. So that's there just to let you know. We will take an offering at the end of the service. If you're visiting with us, we're not asking you for money. But for those here, it's part of our worship. We believe that's part of our worship, the first fruits of what God has given. And I will tell you this. Those that tithe and understand giving, the first fruits of the Lord, understand how God stretches what we have and actually blesses us. And I know some people have an issue with churches and money. And that's why churches need to be good stewards with what God gives them. But that's definitely there. I want to also let you know a couple things. There is a, every Thursday we have a men's Bible study, a breakfast study at Sweet and Smoky at 8 a.m. That's downtown. Love to have you there. It's a great, great opportunity. A lot of our men are going to be at the conference. Actually, they won't leave till Thursday. I'm leaving Thursday, so I won't be able to be there this week. But we do have somebody that's going to be teaching that. Also, Bremerton Farmers Market. I don't know if you noticed, if you came through downstairs, you saw our kettle corn is down there. We are selling that. And that is... that's happened on Thursday. If you would like to come down on Thursday night, 4 to 6, that's where we sell and have an opportunity to just kind of love on people and letting Jesus kind of be there. I know there's been some challenges with that, but we're working through those as well. Also, Women's Bible Breakfast Study is next Saturday. So while the men are gone, the women are going to be having a good time. So that's at 9. That's at 9 a.m. and on the 20th, and that'll be 9:30 on the 20th. I have wrong information, but I'm hoping that everybody that just yelled at me are going, so that would be good. Men's conference is this week. Now listen, Thursday, Ray and Gordon and Jim and one other guy and myself, we're all riding over. We're going to meet at the church at 7 o'clock, and then we're going to hit the 7:20 ferry. Men that are leaving on Friday... The plan is to leave at 6 a.m. Now, that's if we can figure out a couple details. So it's either going to be 6 a.m. or 9 a.m. So what you need to do is contact me, all you men, to let us know. By Wednesday, we'll know that, or by the end of the day. I haven't had a chance to follow up on all this. But I know some are wanting to get out here at 6 a.m. and kind of getting over there. And so there's some potentials. If we can figure out some logistics, they can leave at 6 a.m. from here on Friday. Community Garden Workday next Sunday is going to be interesting because next Sunday we have a concert that's going to be here with Dan and his wife. They're going to do some ministry and music from California. And then following that, we are looking for people to come. I'm expecting all to be here in jeans and have gloves and wheelbarrows. And we need to fit. There's a lot of work that needs to be done out here in the garden. And so right after the service, I believe we'll have some food and just some opportunity to connect. And it's going on out here. That'll be awesome. And then to let you know as well, the Kitsap Harbor Festival is coming up. And that's a huge event because we set up on Friday. And then Saturday and Sunday, we're downtown. And that's with the kettle corn. And then June 11th, just to kind of give you a heads up, June 11th, will be our Biker Sunday. So we will probably have a boatload of bikers. We're gonna have scheduled off the center of our parking lot. All the bikes will be loading up in there from the Christian Motorcycle Association. They're going to do a presentation that morning. We also have our honor-bound graduates from our discipleship from levels 1 and 2. And that will be happening that morning as well. And then we are going to have tents set up in the parking lot, and we're doing a barbecue after the service on the 11th of June. And so after the service, we're going to just head out there and just have a great time, and there'll be lots of food. And then on the next Sunday is Father's Day. It's going to look just like this day, a little bit different. We're going to do a 10 o'clock service, and it's going to be a one-hour 10 o'clock service again on Father's Day. Here's a question I have for you. I want you to talk to me, text me, email me, whatever, but would you be interested in us moving our service to 10 o'clock in the morning? So I want you to be thinking about that for the summer. If we want to do a 10 o'clock just to make it a little earlier, a lot of people have things to do on Sunday they want to be able to get out for, would that be beneficial?
Yes. Wouldn't be Mother's Day without the little
helpers. You felt all alone. Come on, guys.
Okay. Bye-bye. So, mothers, I'm going to have you come around this way, and then you'll go that way. And we're going to let you pick out what flower you want.
Aww.
Your whole one basket. And you get a goodie bag.
Are you
starting? Okay. You boys come over here.
Oh.
Hello.
We heart you. Did all of the mothers get a ticket this morning?
Yes.
Come on through, just grab one.
I don't know.
We need them now?
You're going to need it when you sit down. Because I'm going to make you get back up. On this way. We have a sweet treat this morning. They either have jelly bellies or dinner mints. Because everybody knows our moms are sweet, right?
Those are awesome.
So how many of you have your tickets in your hand? Luke, I have a number. Okay. Just one number. Oh, he's fixing these up. Great. Has anybody got number 32? 32. Come on now.
Well, moms, I want to read another thing here. It's hard to pass, follow that incredible, that gal that did that, she did another one that was it was actually pretty incredible. It was a little different setup. She used all the movies and stuff and kind of tied it into some pretty powerful stuff. But a couple of things that kind of we brought up this week is, you know you're a mom when happy hour is their nap time. You fantasize about sleeping. Cleaning is a pointless exercise. You know the true meaning of 24/7. You have to take a shower on your to-do list. It takes two times longer to get out of the house than it does run in the errands. And you don't speak with adults, you spell with adults. You know you're a mom when you think waking up at 7 a.m. is sleeping in. And having conversations about poop is normal. And you know you're a mom when you have baby wipes in your purse, more baby wipes in your purse than cash. There were 10 momisms that we looked at. Why? Because I said so, that's why. I'm going to give you until the count of three. It's all fun and games until someone gets hurt. I don't know is not an answer. I would never have to talk. I would never talk to my mother that way. I'm not running a taxi service. If everyone jumped off a cliff, would you two do too? She said that one. Someday your face will freeze just like that. It hurts me more than it hurts you. Bob, Sue, Joe, Fido, whatever your name is. The momisms of moms. Amen. Well, Father God, I pray for every mom that is in this place and everybody that's impacted by a mom. None of us would be here without a mom. And I pray that those that have moms will honor those moms today. For those that do not have moms, I pray that she would just comfort and fill those places in their lives. And to be reminded that it's only for a little while. The opportunities and give perspective. And Lord, I pray that all the events of today with family would be just lifted up. And I pray for healing. I pray for restoration. I pray for your goodness and your favor. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, good to see you this morning. I am excited. Next few moments, I have exactly 10 minutes, 15 minutes to unfold to you what I have this morning. And you're all laughing because you're going, that's not possible, right? Especially after last week.
You can do it, Aaron.
We're going to set in here. And I know you may have commitments today. We are staying on track with spiritual warfare. Right? We debated about breaking and doing a Mother's Day message. And just felt like we needed to stay on track with this. In your bulletin, there is notes that are there. I want you to look at the back of the bulletin. There's a prayer. This kind of goes with last week. I gave this to a couple people this last week, and we talked about deliverance last week. If you missed last week's message, I really encourage you to watch it. I'll tell you what, I believe that God wants to set his people free, and I think in that freedom that we can begin to move. I believe revival is coming. I believe some people are saying revival's already here, but I believe it's coming. And we need to be prepared because I believe there's going to be an intense unflow of the people in our community that are going to be coming into this place, into the churches in Bremerton. And we need to get ready for that.
Come on.
This is a great prayer. I got this from Ron. Ron actually found this somewhere, and he showed me a couple weeks ago and said, hey, this is a prayer that I've kind of incorporated. And can I read it to you real quick, and then we're going to jump in. It says, Father, I come to you in the name of Jesus, washed by the blood and guided by the Holy Spirit. I ask your forgiveness for the allowing ungodly thoughts and all corruptible seeds to lay hold of my memory, soul, and any part of my being. I repent for coming into the agreement or entering into the voice of a stranger and every fiery dart from Satan's kingdom. I take my authority as your child, and I bind, blind, mute, and deaf every mind-binding spirit, deaf and dumb spirit, every tormenting and deceiving, condemning, hindering, lying spirits of bondage, insanity, deception, perversion, fear, jealousy, anxiety, anger, pride, resentment, familiar, antichrist, oppression, infirmity, slumber, every strong man, every other spirit associated with any stronghold in my life, and cast them out of me and send them to the pit. I curse every corruptible seed that was planted in my mind, memory, eyes, ears, heart, imaginations, emotions, dreams, and will. I command that these corruptible seeds wither and die, breaking their power and loosing myself from every associated spirit with these seeds. I now cast out the chain and chain these spirits to the fallen angels in hell forever, putting the bloodline of Christ Jesus around these areas, protecting me from the evil penetration. I now bind my mind and my to the mind of Christ and my spirit, soul, and body to the presence of the Lord. His love and truth, I decree that godly thoughts will now arise and reject ungodly thoughts by taking them captive and casting them down. I now gird my mind with the helmet of salvation, increase my faith with the shield and prevent fiery darts from leaving an impression. I love that. Not even leaving an impression.
Yeah.
I decree that I have a sound mind and that cooperates with the mind of Christ, and that he who is in me is greater than he that is in the world.
Yeah.
I now submit to God and resist the devil, casting my cares upon the Lord because he cares for me. I receive the love of Christ and the filling of the Holy Spirit with peace, joy, and righteousness. I thank you, Father, for my new freedom, and I want to be a witness of your power to the world in Jesus' name. That's a good prayer. I'm not one that likes formulas, but I will tell you that's an excellent prayer to incorporate something around that. And if you've not taken time to expose every agreement you've made in your past and your relationships and putting those under the blood, you need to do so. Amen? Because you don't need to be messing with that stuff anymore. Jesus already died for that. He already paid the price and he already nailed it to the cross. So, amen. Let's jump into this, what I have this morning. I want to talk to you about standing this morning. We are called to stand. 1 year ago today, my wife stood here before you and gave a Mother's Day message. That's important because the Tuesday prior to the Mother's Day, that Tuesday right prior to that Sunday of last year, I received a text from her in the middle of the day that simply said, "Can you meet with me?" Immediately, I knew something was wrong. My wife works at a doctor's office. She doesn't usually reach out. And when she said, can you meet with me in the middle of the day, which meant she wasn't at work. So something had seriously been concerning. I knew my spirit dropped. I was actually at Kitsap Sun. I was talking to an editor at the Kitsap Sun at the moment. I had to walk out of the meeting and said, something's wrong. I knew something in my spirit. Something was concerning. I met her at home, and she began to inform me that she had received the results of a biopsy, and she was diagnosed with breast cancer. Within the hour, we were sitting in front of a doctor giving us options and decisions that we would need to make over the next couple of weeks. And I was expecting my wife basically to tell me that she wouldn't be able to minister on Sunday morning, on Mother's Day. But she didn't. And without the congregation knowing anything at this point about this, not even the leadership at this point, she stood up before you, this body, and the first thing out of her mouth was, "I am so blessed." I was shocked. I almost lost it sitting there thinking, gosh, everything we were going through, everything we were looking at. And the first thing, the only thing she could say to the body of Christ is, "I am so blessed." I have learned a lot of things from my wife. And that day, I saw a resolve that she had that was not with a diagnosis or in man, but in a God that was clearly bigger than everything else. I could probably speak with more authority and knowledge about my wife than anyone. Her children would wholly agree with me. Julie is probably one of the most godly people I've ever met through and through. I am so amazed with her. I'm amazed with her resolve and her stand for Christ. There are times, I have to say, over the last 30 years that I have quivered in my faith that she has not. And she has stayed true and strong. We've been working, you haven't known this because I haven't actually made this known to you, but if you look through the messages the last 3 weeks, we're actually been focused in Ephesians chapter 6. And we've been slowly moving through verses 10 on. And this morning I want to look at two verses in particular, verse 13 and 14. It says, "Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground. And after you've done everything to stand, stand then firm." Satan wants us to run at all costs. His goal today is to simply get you off your footing and to get you run in any direction. He doesn't care which, just get you to run. And the moment we run, we are no longer in the path that God has called us to. Peter says in 1 Peter 5:8, "Be self-controlled and alert. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour." But it says in Proverbs 28, "The wicked run and flee. The wicked man flees, though no one pursues. But a righteous are as bold as a lion."
Amen.
Paul tells Timothy in 2 Timothy 1:7, "For God did not give us a spirit of timidity or fear, but a spirit of power, love, and self-discipline." How many spiritual battles are lost simply because no one was willing to stand? See, I think this is huge, and we could talk about all kinds of things in spiritual warfare, and we're going to talk about strategies of the enemies and breakdowns, because we need to be aware of those so that we can understand, we can see them and know them when they come, because we have been given authority to stand, to trample the enemy. And we don't talk about spiritual warfare that much. I think a lot of other things we'd like to talk about a little bit more. But this is something that I want to tell you something. The enemy has been able to thwart many believers and followers of Christ and keep them from becoming what God has called them to be. Somebody came in this morning and was asking me about these DNA things you can do online. Is there a problem? I don't have a problem with that. But did you know that God has a spiritual DNA that he's put inside of you? And his spiritual DNA, he wrote before the foundations of the world. And that DNA has an outcome that's very different than what many of us have experienced or many of us have touched into, simply because we've been sifted by the wheat of the wind through the enemy has come, and through our past, through our families, through relationships, through brokenness, through sin, through hurts and pains, we've become limited where God has wanted us to step out. If the enemy can get you to run, you are no longer, as I mentioned before, on the path that God has commissioned you to. And you end up in battles God had never intended you to fight. And if he can distract you from victory that God wants to show you. In facing spiritual warfare, I just want to take a few minutes and I want to talk to you about this idea of standing. And that God has called you to stand. And there are four areas that I believe God has called us to stand. I'm just going to give these to you real quick this morning. And let you move. But I hope that you'll just let these sink in your heart, because I want you to know this. Every time you take a stand, hear me. I don't care how big Goliath is. I know the giant is in your life. I don't care how big the storm is. I don't care how big the mountain is. Every time you take a stand, you are a majority when you are with God.
Amen.
It doesn't matter what you see. I'm telling you, the word tells you, greater is he. Come on. That is within you. And when you take a stand, but the enemy wants you to run on every cost. And if he can get you to run, if he can simply get you to scatter, you are no longer in victory. You've lost the ground that God has given you. Four areas this morning I just want you to consider in standing. Number one, and this is huge, is that we need to stand for who he is in you. Stand for who he is in you. You are the apple of his eye this morning. He has come to set you free. Don't give up the ground he has worked out in you. Paul says in Philippians 1:6, he will complete the work he began in you. He is faithful. Jude 24 says he is able to keep you from falling and present you before his glorious presence without fault with great joy. Amen?
Amen.
Isaiah 7:9 says, if you do not stand firm in your faith, you will not stand at all. You understand your faith is the foundation of everything else. And when our faith gets shaken, we begin to quiver in our faith. We lose the resolve. Everything else is gone. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Then what? All these things. Not some of these things. Not most of these things. Not a majority. All of these things will be added unto you. Church, I want to tell you something. When the crisis comes, when the storm hits, stop turning to man. Stop turning to what you think you know. Turn to Jesus. Get your eyes focused on him as the author and perfecter of your faith. Stay focused on the faith that he has put in you. It does not matter what is around you. That week when my wife was diagnosed, we did not know what that meant. Cancer is a scary word, and those who face cancer in their family and lives know that that is a hugely scary word. And as we sat in front of that doctor, and I sat there, I was really trying to figure out what the next step was, what it was going to look like, what was the battle, what were we facing. My wife's mom died of cancer, her grandmother died of cancer, and her great-grandmother died of cancer. And I'll tell you what, like I've told you many times, I am Chicken Little, and most days the sky is falling, and I have to get in the Word to get composure. And it's when I'm in the Word that all of a sudden the world comes back into order. But I will tell you this, my wife did not run. I wanted to run. I was ready to buy the plane ticket. But she did not run. And as the diagnosis kept coming and as we were getting further, there were things, decisions we had to make that were scary. Didn't know. There were tests that had to be done. And if they were done, they could affect us being able to get life insurance for her for the rest of her life. And wondering what's her. And I'll tell you what, but my wife, she stood her ground and she said, I'm not going to run. We're going to wait upon God.
Hallelujah.
And over the year knew what happened. Many of you don't, because it's not a big thing. Some people really have to go. My wife, her big thing is, I don't want people to even know about this, because of what God has done in her life makes some people feel really bad, even in her own family. Holidays, they approach her and they go, well, we understand, we hear this. And then my wife has to kind of backtrack and say, yeah, but you know what? I'm not dealing with this anymore. And they're kind of like, what does that mean? It's because Jesus kind of work through because she didn't run. And I want to tell you, sometimes we will get a diagnosis, sometimes we will get an attack, and because we run, we create more problems than the original concern. And God has the original concern under control. We just can't see that side of it. Stand for who He is in you. Amen?
Amen.
Number two, stand for your family. You are the strong man or the strong woman of your home. And you need to, if you do not stand, I'll tell you, it says that if you do not stand, you will not stand at all. I love the story of Rizpah. How many know the story of Rizpah? 2 Samuel. Powerful story. Here's a mother who was the concubine of Saul. And because of Saul's improprieties, because of his struggles and things he did, he had wronged a group of people called the Gibeonites. Now, they were already wronged Israel because Israel did not take them out. They stayed in the land and lied about it. But he had wronged them horribly. And King David was struggling. He knew something. He wasn't seeing favor. He wasn't seeing movement. He sought after the Lord, said, "What's wrong?" And he says, "You need to address these Gibeonites because there's a stench because of what Saul had done as king." So David went to the Gibeonites. And he says, "What do I need to do? What do we need to do to make this right? We need to restore this." They said, "Here's what we want. We take Saul's children and let us hang them and display them and humiliate them for what Saul had done to us." Now, two of those children belonged to one of Saul's concubines by the name of Rizpah. Can you imagine a mother going to lose her two sons because of something a king had did or didn't do? And so those sons were turned over. And the story goes in 2 Samuel chapter 21. That these boys were all strung up and hung on a tree, left for the birds of the air and the those that crawled on the ground would come and devour them.
Yeah.
But you know what Rizpah did? She could not control the outcome of what was there. Most people would have said it's too beyond. They're dead. There's nothing you can do. But this mother took a piece of sackcloth and she laid it on a rock and for 3 months stayed out next to her boys hanging on a tree. And day and night, you know what she did? She fought off the birds, she fought off the coyotes, the wolves, she fought off everything that tried to come and touch her boys. For 3 months through a rainy season, people had to bring food out to her because she says, "I will not leave, I will stand my ground." And because of that, her boys were taken down and brought into honor. Their bones were laid at rest in the honor of the kings. I will tell you this, when is it too far to go to stand for your family or your children? I want to tell you, mothers, there's never a time that they've gone too far. There's never a time that it's beyond God's reach. And some of you mothers need to take a piece of sackcloth and you need to fight day and night. Set yourself up. Do not run, but set yourself up and stand for your family, because if you don't, who will? Amen? It says in 2 Samuel 21:10, Rizpah, daughter of Aiah, took sackcloth and spread out for herself on a rock. And from the beginning of the harvest till the rain poured down from the heavens on the body, she did not let the birds of the air touch them by day or the wild animals by night. But you break that down, it's 3 months. Can you imagine that? Number three, we need to stand for the ground that God has given you. Did you know that God has given you ground? When you came to the Lord, the Bible says that we're called to go back into the enemy's camp and take back what he stole from us. Amen?
Amen.
And the ground that has... And how many times have I seen people who have surrendered their lives to Christ and have begun to take ground in their lives of their freedom and their deliverance, but somewhere along stopped standing for it and have turned tail and lost it? There's a story of one of David's mighty men. His name was Eliezer. And you know what he stood for? A bean patch. But check this out. Samuel chapter 2 Samuel 23:9 says, "Next to him was Eliezer, son of Dodai, and the Ahite, how you pronounce that, as one of the three mighty men. He was with David when they taunted the Philistines and gathered at Pasdamim for battle. And then the men of Israel retreated." So in other words, they're there for a battle. They're holding on to ground that God had given Israel. And Eliezer's standing there with an army. But as they look at the army that's coming their way, they turn in white, and they got freaked out, and they took off and left. And the only one left standing in the bee patch was Eliezer. He's the only one left. And he decided himself, I'm going to continue to stand here. And he took on an entire army. Everybody else deserted him, and he stood there and says, I'm not giving up. An entire army came at him, and it says this. It says, but he stood his ground and struck down the Philistines till his hand grew tired and froze to the sword. And the Lord brought about a great victory that day. One man against an entire army. And his adrenaline was so up. Can you imagine an army coming? That his hand froze. They had to pry, as other translators done, they had to pry the sword out of his hand because he had so connected. It says the Lord brought about such a great victory. The troops returned after the battle, but only to strip the dead. Church, I want to tell you something. If we're talking about spiritual warfare, if we do not stand, we're going to miss what God wants to do through us. And it does not matter what you're standing, what you're facing. If you will not run, you will see incredible victory of what God wants to do in your life. Amen? Yeah. My last point, and we're going to shut this down, is to stand in the gap for the land. Ezekiel 22:30 says, I look for a man among them who would build up a wall and stand before me in the gap and on behalf of the land, so I would have to destroy it, but I found none. Let me ask you this. Who's going to stand in the gap for Bremerton and Kitsap County?
Come on.
I don't want to be at a point to say, well, you know what? If only somebody would have taken a stand in Bremerton. If only someone would have taken a stand in my family. If only someone would have taken a stand in my life.
Come on.
If only somebody would have taken a stand for what God has done in me and through me. My encouragement to you simply this Mother's Day morning is that you would simply stand. My wife, she came through all the procedures, the surgeries, everything that we needed to. And we watched as God simply stood, as she stood her ground, we watched as God took her through a process. But at the end of the day, my wife today is cancer-free. Let me tell you how the enemy works. I told you, my wife's mom, she's adopted. Her bio mom died 2 or 3 years after we met her of colon cancer at the age of 37. Her grandmother died. She had breast cancer. Her great-grandmother had breast cancer. Now, that's pretty scary. And the doctor came and said, we need to do a geno test on you. We were at a moment, I'm like freaking out. And do you know what? They did the geno test. I want to tell you how the enemy works. They did the geno test. Of all 12 or 13, I can't remember how many there was of the test, she came back negative. My wife has no genes for cancer.
Come on.
But the enemy had kept us, and I want to tell you, it had kept us for many years in fear of what was going to happen. And could she have cancer? Could she die of cancer? But I want to tell you, through that process, the one thing today, this last year, there was fear, but because she stood and went through this today, there is absolutely no fear.
Yes, praise. Come on.
It's an area of victory that is there. And praise God. And I know not everybody has that story when it comes to cancer. But I will tell you this. God is good. But I will tell you, the enemy wants you to believe the very worst in every situation, in every relationship. But if you will stop running and let him show you his power in and through you, man, then we were going to start to take ground that has yet to be taken. Amen.
Amen.
Father God, I pray that you would be just that resolve, Father, of a mother that has for her children. Lord, that we would walk with that resolve to take our stand and to not let the enemy thwart what you're doing in and through us and around us. We ask your goodness and your favor in this, in Jesus' precious name. Amen. 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 We're going to take an offering. Closing. So the offering is going to come up at this time. Mothers, bless you. May you be honored today above all else. Amen. And I want to thank you for your faithfulness and goodness and generosity. If you would take that card that you filled out with your name, just put that in the offering. As we take an offering this morning, I just want to thank you for your generosity. It's because of what you do that we're able to progress and do what God has for us as a church. Amen. So your faithfulness is imperative to what God has. Jesus, bless this offering. Bless our worship to you, Father. that, Lord, that we would give you the first fruits of our time, our relationships, our possessions, Father. That, Lord, that you would take what you have laid upon us, that you would extend it beyond to meet every need that we have in our lives as well. In Jesus' name we pray. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
What does amen stand for?
Amen.
In Hebrew, amen.
God's amazing love that is shining.
Thank you. I appreciate the worship team. Thank you very much. I appreciate the mothers. 14 years ago, about 10 years ago, my mom developed cancer and passed away. I walked into the room, the hospice room that she was doing. She couldn't communicate. She couldn't talk. She couldn't even recognize who we were. But she was laying on the bed with her hand in the air. And she was mumbling. So I know she was praising the Lord. So the greatest thing that we can do is if your mother's here, hug her, love on her. Because when they're gone, they're gone. So go home, have a nice celebration, and have a good time. Our Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus, we just thank you. We thank you for the mothers. We thank you for the service. We thank you for everything that you do in our lives, because we know, Lord Jesus, we know that you have a special design for each and every one of us. And we need to recognize that design, and we need to work on it and worship you. We thank you. We ask it in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
God bless you.
He's leading to me.
You're not out here.